Hi, my name is Christopher Ho, and I'm moderating this fantastic panel. So I'm going to start out with a question for all of you. This notion of the stutter, the fragment, the metaphor of the tiger that eludes, and the blind spot, I think is a consistency in all of your presentations. And I'd like to say, or I'd like to think, that beyond these blind spots and stutters, you are all perhaps reaching for some sort of thing after. And Anthony, I think you described it very well when you said, for the Analects, seeing beyond conflict, which is to say, despite the fragmentary nature of the Analects, there is something beyond. For, I think, Jennifer, for me, watching your piece, to me, it seemed like a collage of different media, but the moment when the brass band walked in, we were grounded, and for more than a few minutes, there was coherency, and there, the fragments congealed into something that, for me at least, I could feel and get behind. And so it is this search, perhaps, for a myth that I would like to ask you to speak about more. Not the fragment, but what comes after.
That's a really interesting premise. In fact, I think that's really where we started. We had a few technical difficulties, so we couldn't, and in the end, there was supposed to be a clip of the opera. So our piece is about making this opera that we did, Guillermo and I worked on last year, and we brought in Ron. And the idea was that Ron would act out all these ideas or voices in the head when you're in the making process. So it's very fragmented, and there are lots of voices that come through, influences, you're reading, you're watching, you're seeing shows, you're getting ideas. But between that to the finished product, there's something very mysterious. And when the brass band came out, it was Ron channeling Papa Legba to open the gate for creativity to come through. And then we're supposed to show a little bit clip of the opera and showing how different it was. But we didn't quite get that part. So I feel like we're still kind of in the fragmented state. And also, when Leeza first asked me to do something, I was like, well, I can do a slideshow, talk about the opera. But I thought, you know, to show the kind of the alchemy of the making process might be interesting. But I did warn her. I was like, you know, I don't know how it's going to go. And so I feel like we are in many different parts still kind of congealing. But it's nice to know that the band part worked.
Well, it all worked. I mean, I think that the idea of the interruption that becomes an extended interruption and which becomes perhaps the real or displaces the real is something that was impressed and is a consistency. Do you guys want to add to Jennifer's response?
Yeah, I could do, I guess. You know, I think what comes after is also an open space that's created for the audience. You know, for me, it's very much, I think, there's almost a kind of mediumistic relationship in the kind of evocation and invocation of history. And in that way, you're kind of just lining up your ducks, you know, that kind of somehow the ducks give rise to the pattern that lies behind the screen of history. And in a sense, then, actually, to do more than that is to start to reimpose. And then history concretizes again. So in a weird way, I mean, I didn't quite get round to it because I didn't also think it was necessary as part of the presentation, but around Kalimpong, actually, there's an artist's book, there's an exhibition, there's a whole virtual reality environment to sort of explore. So there's almost a tripartite layering, and each of those layers has layers. You know, I often think it's like, you know, why would you just have a singular rabbit hole?
Anthony, are you dying to say something?
No, I'm not dying to say anything. Sincerely, I'm not. Only that I think that there must have been, on some part, this is too somber to talk about, but I think there had to be a sense of some kind of tribute to my father. There must have been, and it was something in the back of my head, and the idea that the fragmentation could be alleviated with the sense of the whole of the Tao. What I expected to get out of it, I don't know. I don't know. Sorry.
I guess for me, the usage of the fragments is actually to try to reach out to a bigger whole, you know. So using this fragmented sort of like histories, like historical moments, you know, just the very choice of the tiger as a motif to kind of relook history, you know. So kind of trying to open up history to sort of other forms of life, you know, the tiger, and also this broader ecological questions. So I guess what I'm after is always this bigger whole. I'm not quite sure what that is, you know. So I think these are fragments, but the fragments resonate, or you know, maybe each of these fragments is a repetition and a differentiation of the previous fragment. So these are the kinds of structures that I was after.
Well, this idea of the fragments all adding up to something whole, I think it refers to the initial slide that you showed. And something that struck me about your comment, and actually Shezad, you mentioned something about the audience and the public in your response, is that you all deploy relatively a mixed bag, but nonetheless establish forms of public entertainment or artistry. So from puppet theater to storytelling and books to children's books perhaps and to opera. And I think that mix or stitching together of media, old and new, CGI was in there, virtual and real theme parks, virtual hotels and real theme parks. That's something else I would love to hear more about too, is what your backgrounds are, how you chose or came to the medium of opera, for instance, Chinese opera as well as Western opera. That's something I would love to hear more about.
I'm a visual artist by training, and I became interested in opera by chance. Professionally, I mean, besides going to see it. So I just had an idea stuck in my head about 3 years ago, and it was just one of those things that was nagging and wouldn't go away, and I was talking to a lot of theater friends to say, oh, let's work on something together, and no one invited me, so I said, I'll just do it myself. And because it was my first opera, and I had no idea how complicated it would be, and now, knowing what I know now, I might have, you know, other ways of approaching or have a second thought. But at the time, I was like, yeah, I'll just do it. I'll write it, and I'll just start designing it, and something will come of it. But it was enormously difficult. Very rewarding, but it took 3 years to make it. I mean, we're very fortunate. We had a debut in New York at Lincoln Center Festival this summer. But that was also such a precise medium because, you know, once you're in the opera house, how you do things, every second counts, you know, you have an orchestra, it was a completely different thing. So when I was thinking about making this piece, for example, I wanted to throw away the script, we want to make it very improvisational, I really left a lot of unknowns for each one to bring in, you know, to bring in their aspect, so there are a lot of unknowns. So it was kind of maybe this was the reaction, not against, but rose out of practice. I don't know if you want to add anything, Guillermo, who is also a media artist and did work in opera.
Yeah, thinking of the unknowns and the knowns, right, we did the opera and we're not so used to something so strict, you know, and when you're doing it, it's incredibly strict. But the whole process isn't, right? When you're thinking of creating something, it's such a whirlwind of anything that is coming through your head, and some of it sticks, and some of it goes away, and then some come back again. So we kind of went there, and this whole process actually took us here, and it was thanks to Papa Legba through this guy here that really helped us I think it was get a little bit closer to the whole unknown that you were talking about first. And strange things happen. Right? Very strange things include.
Okay. Well, I'm an artist and filmmaker, and necessarily, you know, research and writing forms a large part of that. And I guess I have a lot of maverick developer coder friends, and had been experimenting with the technology for a number of years. But it was really with Kalimpong, something just came together. It was both the technology, I think, had got to the point where it felt right to kind of, I was able to do what I wanted to do with it, very simply. And then also because of the nature of Kalimpong as a subject, and obviously that whole region is a center of esoteric Buddhism. And esoteric Buddhism has been talking about reality being a hologram for over 1,000 years. So it was the perfect frame within which to kind of use VR, I felt, because I was very wary, A, about the technology not being good enough, and I think also a lot of the discourse around it was, I just felt a bit in a bubble, this whole idea that a lot of discourse around virtual technologies, you know, treats itself as having a 20 to 50 year history rather than a 2,000 or 5,000 or, you know, 10,000 year history of consciousness. And, you know, it was that ability to kind of, obviously you just got the barest hint of it there, but I really wanted to take people on that journey. So it was as much about, it was almost more a philosophical journey than a, you know, the technology was supporting a philosophical inquiry rather than the other way around.
What strange things happened? Can I, may, wait, no, wait, may, this, I want to talk about strange things. May I ask a question? When did you add the Leonard Cohen line? Did you do it this morning?
This, like 12 noon today.
Okay.
We did a lot of changes after what's happened this week, actually. It really, I think, shifted the tone of this piece, okay. The events of this week.
I opened up the newspaper, and of course, I didn't see who I expected to see for the first time since July, and I saw Leonard Cohen. And one line went through my head. There's a crack in everything. It's how the light gets in. And, you know, I'm looking at that and I'm thinking, well, I guess that means it's okay to foul up today or something. You know, you're like, if we look for signs, you know, what does it mean? Leonard Cohen died. What does it mean to me? And I'm backstage and then Cohen comes on, you know.
That song, yeah.
That line, yeah. Which was the line that went through
which
my head. And I think it's probably, it's the line that you brought up. Yeah. So I guess perhaps that's the line that runs through many of us. But I got it, my knees almost went out from under me. When that happened,
and you know, we had recovery in it, right? Recovery was part of it from some months ago already, and this week we were looking for. I mean, how do we do recovery, right?
How do we start?
And again, Papa Legba came up with Cohen
and Toni Morrison.
Yeah,
I mean, a lot of people are in pain. So, but the art continues, right? So, but when I heard Leonard Cohen pass, it was kind of like, damn. The first thing that came was like, wow, where's that crack? Where's the light? So I was like, well, we have to add this to it because then that will bring everything together. At least that's at least for us, some of us that understands that. That's why.
Well, let's extend that, Anthony, your question to Shezad and to Nyen before opening up to the audience. I think the question on everyone's mind is, did recent news events recast or affect how you presented and how you see or approach the materials that you presented? Well, I'm thinking of the U.S. election, but I think that's open for interpretation. What major recent events have occurred?
No, I wouldn't say that events this week altered in any way what this project was about. You know, so
that's
this,
good to know, actually.
Yeah,
I think that's a totally valid answer.
Sure. Absolutely. Yeah, so this is a project that I began almost 6 or 7 years ago. And it also took many different forms, from a theatrical performance to a video installation. You know, it's just this sense that each manifestation of the project was not... I couldn't exhaust the materials that I was interested in. Or maybe it's a sense of sort of getting possessed, like by the tiger, you know. But earlier you were asking the question of mediums and this like different kinds of mediums. You know, like when we think of the word medium in Southeast Asia, we think of the mass media medium, but also the medium as a spirit medium, as a, in the sense of a channeling of spirits. So I think these two sense of the word medium was pretty much conflated like in a lot of the projects that I did. So I just saw each of them as a manifestation of the tiger's return, you know. So this project continues growing. So maybe recent events might affect it like in the future, but I think it's quite unlikely though, important as these events are, of course.
Well, I don't know, there was a sense maybe in coming from England of a doom foretold, you know? And I think, you know, interestingly with kind of what we did in June, you know, and Kalimpong was staged, the exhibition that you saw some images of was staged in London in September. And, you know, I think after an initial kind of a very deeply personal struggle and, you know, there was a sense of taking refuge in the kind of cyclical function of history, you know, which from my, you know, Asian roots, cyclical is a kind of a priori condition. Whereas having been brought up in England, there's this sort of myth of progress, which actually from even a, you know, you don't have to do much research to know that, you know, technology might progress, but actually, you know, I mean, one of the kind of interesting things, you know, which I love to kind of unearth in the research, not just for Kalimpong, but for other projects, is how the same set of interactions of power, manipulation, you know, dissimulation and sleight of hand are the kind of very operation of the veil of power. So, you know, it's both, you know, there's that sort of personal, visceral thing, but then you kind of have to reincorporate it and think about how you step back and see actually what's really going on, what's playing out again and again and again. You know, hence sort of prefacing my presentation about it's been an interesting year in geopolitics, folks, you know.
Well, let's open it up to audience questions.
Why? Why are poets dangerous?
Poems. You said poems were dangerous. So why? Why are they so dangerous?
Words cast spells. I believe that. I don't know how potent the spell would be, but I believe that words cast spells. They're the medium through which we reinterpret experience and phenomena. So they can cast spells. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's okay. A great answer.
No, I think good novels are probably poetic. I think poetry is in the silences between words as well. That's not my idea. That's John Chardy. But he said that words explode. There are these small explosions in our neurons when we read two words next to each other.
This is for Osu. Regarding your use of tigers and the sort of fantasy construction of the Indian or Southeast Asian labor, convict, whatnot, what I was really struck by is there's an incredibly strong fantasy element in British colonial novels about, like, the, you know, Indiana Jones is a sort of a lovely 20th century version of the 19th century British colonial adventure. And I'm kind of curious if, like, this idea of, like, the fantasy construction of the tiger plays into your reading of the colonial history or the colonial historian adventure itself.
Oh, could you repeat the question?
Oops, sorry. Okay, let me try that again. All right, so I was really struck by your use of tiger, the richness of metaphorical allusions that you draw out of the tiger. And so what I'm curious about is, like, when one reads colonial, British colonial novels from the 19th century, one gets a really rich fantasy element from the British colonial writer, the policeman, so on and so forth. So I'm kind of curious about, like, this tiger is very much often the subject of the British colonial policemen's, it's the object of their vision, and it turns them into a hunter as well as a policeman. And I'm kind of curious if, like, British colonial fantasy constructions of masculinity play into your reading of the tiger.
Yeah, I think the tiger would definitely sort of, in this narrative, in this tracking of the tiger, it definitely represents a certain kind of masculine predatory force. Yeah. So, yeah, what is that? Actually, I wasn't quite sure what the question, I couldn't hear, I'm sorry, yeah.
I just wanted to know about masculinity and construction of fantasy self for the British colonial adventure was, and if that played into your semi-imaginary narrative art.
Okay. Never mind. Is the amplification?
There is weird amplification here.
Yeah.
My sense, the gist of the question is that you spoke about surveying and Dutch as well as other European colonizers to Southeast Asia. But I believe the question is also not necessarily about colonizers and colonized, but also about masculinity and how perhaps colonial myths or myths perpetuated by colonizers might also wrap into, might also be gendered.
Also be
gendered. Yeah. Thank you.
I mean, I think we can also broaden this question to the rest of the participants here. We had three guys, Confucius, your dad, and Jack Kerouac. I mean, that's going to be notable. We had, you know, so I think that we could also, I think we can bring up the topic of masculinity and put that on the table, and let's start with let's have that as a topic for a moment.
My father was a man.
Just real quick, in Chinese, we often talk about a female tiger, mu lao hu. It's like a saying, you know, so not necessarily tigers has to be masculine, anyway.
But I do think in the specific sort of a narrative in this tracking so far, they were inevitably like very masculine figures that I was tracking. And these were also kind of really symbols of a particular form of power, you know. So, and it's almost, you know, these tigers that I was tracking, they are almost sort of repetitions of each other. So, I hope that somehow answers your question.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Chris, can I say something? Seriously. Okay, wait, how should I say? All right, I'll take a breath. So, the reality is, if we're talking about identity and gender as being linked to identity, I'll say this, and I'm not sure where it goes, but somebody gets cut loose. When I was young, my father told me not to read Jack Kerouac. So, I don't know why, by the way. I never asked him, but he said, "Don't." He said, "Don't bother. Don't bother reading Kerouac." So
he wanted you to be an ad man, not a poet.
Maybe.
And I guess, you know, it's interesting because although I end up with a lot of guys in Kalimpong, it all begins with Alexandra David Neal. In a way, I mean, she was genuinely a kind of childhood hero of mine. And it's amazing that she kind of sets the tone and throws out the rule book for what comes after. You know, nobody quite does. I mean, she did kind of pretty, I mean, whether you believe all her accounts or not, I mean, she lived quite an amazing and incredible life and was doing things that nobody was doing, you know, whether man or woman at that time.
Like what?
Well, she adopted a Tibetan son. There's various accounts of her escaping from, or literally being stuck inside remote forts in the Himalayas with attacking bandits, cutting people's heads off and leaving them on spikes. And, you know, it's kind of, she was the kind of the real deal, you know, even if it is, I mean, a lot of people say some of it's made up and a lot of it's exaggerated, but even taking that into account, there's, you know, she had bigger balls than all the other men I talked about.
I think there is a question midway.
I'd like to say something too. I think what I'm so impressed about is this sort of global unity where different cultures and approaches are respected and presented. And I think really seeing like the best components of what the future of the world might be here right now represented.
Well, thank you for that.
Thank you.
I think more than masculinity, it's showing the white race as superior. In all British colonial literature, paintings, you know, the natives are scrambling, the tiger may attack them, but the white overseer is erect, he's got an umbrella, his face is impassive, he's brave. The same rules were followed in Hollywood for a long time. It was the Native American who looked terrible, it was the Vietnamese who was crying, but not the great white hero. So this is the same thing followed through their literature. So superiority rather than masculinity. The other thing is the convicts had not really done anything. What had happened is their land had been stolen due to very exorbitant taxation. And they were not allowed to grow food. So if they stole any food or anything, they were put into jail and then used as labor. The same thing was followed in Africa with the Maasai, etc. So it was essentially the same kind of private prisons that we are seeing today.
Would you like to respond to that? Yeah. And then I think one more question.
Yeah, just very quickly, you know, in the image with the white colonial man and the tiger, this was actually sort of the focus of my project in the last year. But for me, the next year, what I would like to look at were actually the Indian convicts. So for me, that was actually a way to get out of this binary between the native, you know, tiger and the white colonial, is to look at these eight other figures, which was sort of where my presentation was leading to, which was kind of my research for the next project. But, you know, as I was thinking about the question of masculinity as well, I think more than just, you know, this idea of male power and tigers, I think an added layer of complexity is that we were also looking at were tigers. So they were not just solely men, but also a certain, you know, there's a certain kind of a slippage or oscillation like between the human and the animal. So that, and also this question of the water, you know, as a lubricant for metamorphosis, which kind of linked up with the water bits, with the Taoist water bits in his presentation as well, which I think gives it a little bit of fluidity as well. Yeah.
I think there was a question over here.
Oh, thank you. Let's get back to the female area again. So I would like to ask Jennifer maybe to explain a little bit more, as I understood that you are a visual artist, right? So why do you interested in opera? Is there any specific sort of reason? And then maybe you can explain a little bit more about how do you collaborate, you work together with other artists. Thank you.
About four years ago, I did this installation in Beijing called Hanging Garden in Ink, which was part of, there were a lot of different things I was thinking about making the opera that were on the background images, but it was a 60-foot long, 20-foot tall installation that suspended in mid-air that had 1,500 live plants, like suspended like a hanging garden, and half of it's right side up, the other half is upside down, mirroring each other. And all the plants were painted black with Chinese ink, but they're alive, they're growing over a period of time, green will come into it. And as part of that installation, the museum asked me to think about public programming for the space. So I thought, it's a very dramatic space, and where the audience walks, all the trees are upside down, black. So we end up doing a short Quinn opera piece called Interrupted Dream from Peony Pavilion, where the main, it's a very famous sequence where the main protagonist, a woman, she's about 15 years old, she falls asleep in the Peony Pavilion, the garden, she dreams of this amazing lover, and they have a very charged erotic experience, but when she wakes up, he's gone. In the original opera, she actually dies from lovesickness and has to go through hell and be reborn and be reunited with her lover. It was 20 hours long. It was very dramatic. But the experience of doing that, staging that little 40, 30-minute piece was very interesting. It was very charged. This, you know, otherwise dramatic but quiet installation that I had. I just found that the energy between the audience and the performer and adding time into this installation was super interesting. So that's really what got me started. So I was thinking, talking to various people, like I was saying earlier, no one wanted to really do it. Everyone says, great, that's a great idea, but nothing ever came of it. So I started thinking about the garden, and I thought about utopia, paradise, and I wanted to create a garden that would just fold out of nothing. So that's what you saw. That was a model that I made for Performa a couple years ago. And then eventually we made a much bigger one for the opera so that it would just fold down like a book and part of like Chinese scroll painting or folding paper origami using these really simple principles. So I just kind of started there and showed that model to various people who I wanted to work with and hooked them in and then worked on it. And then Guillermo and I worked on this, and I think what we worked on, this small piece was kind of indicative of how I like to make or collaborate. I just come out with an idea, I kind of put it on the table and say, what do you guys think? Are you interested, not interested? What, which part of you, which part might you find, you know, align with your own practice? So anyway, I don't know if you guys want to respond on collaboration, but that's kind of the, where I came in.
Well, collaboration is not easy in theory. However, I mean, with Jennifer, it's very easy because what she'll do is she'll bring an idea, right? And then you'll bring your ideas, and then there's structure, right? And you start working together. It's not a, it's very important that it's not separate things happening and then suddenly at the end, you know, coming together. It is a long process. It's a lot of work, but it works pretty well, better than most things actually.
It's not linear either. I'm just saying it's not a linear process. It's kind of, the idea for the piece we worked on today was, it starts with one, like a stream. It starts with one stream, then another stream, and then it becomes this like amazing cacophony of things coming in and out. So we each bring what we felt that was needed to add to that stream to make it this running torrent. And that kind of ties in also to your water changing in a medium being possessed. So that was part of it. At the end, all that stream come together to Legba, and we got possessed by that energy and opened the way for that to flow.
And cyclical too.
Yeah.
We're talking about cyclical things. Things are not always progressive, but cyclical.
Well, I think that's a great thought and great note to end this session with. Thank you guys all.